With that, ladies and gentlemen, we now move into very detailed communications, technical communications with our technical session, the first panel discussion of the day as we begin. And the topic which we have is space startups connecting to international markets with emerging business models. Today, if you see, the Indian startup ecosystem is home to approximately 60,000 active startups, which is inclusive of both funded and bootstrap startups. So the discussion which we are going to be having with our esteemed panelists here is on factors of financing and business models that build the space ecosystem and enable them to connect with the international markets. I welcome the chair of the session, Mr. N. Sudhir Kumar, the Director Capacity Building Program Office, ISRO headquarters, and he's responsible for industrialization, indigenization, technology transfer, technical infrastructure, and outreach activities of ISRO. Also, a very hearty welcome to the moderator of the session, Mr. Abhishek Malhotra, founding partner, TMT Law Practice. He has more than two decades of extensive experience in the primary areas of expertise, including intellectual property, commercial dispute resolution, technology, media, and telecommunications. And let me also welcome all our panelists who join us in this discussion. Mr. Sanjay Nikanti, Managing Director of Dhruva Space, Mr. Srinath Ravichandran, the CEO of Agnikul Cosmos, Mr. Sunil Indurthi, Director at Agista Aerospace, Mr. Karthik Ravindra, COO of Satshore, and Ms. Neha Satak, the CEO of Astrom Technologies. So welcome to everyone on board. And with that, we are good to begin with our discussions. And I would like to hand over to the chair of the session for his opening remarks and then the further proceedings of the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chaudhary. I'm Sudhir. At present, I'm working as a director in the Capacity Building Program Office of ISRO headquarters. And the startup faces I'm seeing, they're quite familiar to me. Probably, I think when you are talking about the current industry scenario, if you don't talk about the startup, it is something like that. Taking a rice without any recipe. Okay, I think probably the startups would be the future choices of the very competitive as well as very innovative space building process. What I could see. Probably, I think if you allow, I'll just make a small presentation. What I made it just for building the gaps. The startup program started way back into 2016 by Honorable Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi sir. Then of course, some of the startup criteria are very noted to the many of the people. For the other people who are presenting offline, this could be a 1 second snapshot view, which has got 10 years of less than 10 years of experience, 100 lakh crores turnover, which are involved in the innovative business. This innovative has to be underlined by the people who are the entrepreneurs, who are upcoming entrepreneurs. But already started told by Mrs. Chaudhary that this is the third largest startup ecosystem in the world, India, with a growth rate of 12 to 15%. Already 2018, it is 50,000 startups are there, but in other fields, over 1,300 startups in 2019. Some of the statistics will roll on. But I came across a very nice report, NASSCOM, most of you would have gone through, which talks about the statistics of the startups, where you see that the distribution of the startups are more in enterprise, health, fintech, HR, retail tech, SCM, logistics, automotive. But when you see the deep tech, still this is very virgin field. And if you take in seeing the deep tech also, artificial intelligence, machine learning, IoT, big data management, blockchain, these are all the areas which are basically covered by the nascent startups, virgin startups. But there is an abundant scope for growth, especially when you see the space, because space has got abundant data, which will touch upon each and every area of the common interest. Nowadays, startups picking up the space. Why? Because there is a Make in India campaign which will attract the Indian-born startups. New startup hubs are getting generated every day to day. Digital infrastructure is becoming very healthy and it is increasing day by day. Government reforms and enabling the user facilities, this will help the startups to make use of the opportunities. And government seed funding and encouragement to incubators, this is operate started from this year onwards, which will be very handy for the startups. Of course, globalization policies, in case if some of the startups have got some counterparts in abroad and they can start the FDAs. And when I just came across this particular slide, which is very relevant, is if I just want to spend some time on this one, improving the infrastructure support. And NASSCOM has taken the ISRO as one of the example in this one. Now ISRO, after the reforms, it has thrown open the doors for the startups and MSMEs to make use of the facilities. This is very rarest to the rarest, that is an opportunity.
Which so government the slides has. Are not moving.
Is it okay?
Yeah, now it is
fine. Okay, fine. So, and you are able to see, sir, movement or not there right now? The space part of encouragement program, which we started in ISRO with an objective of indigenization, building competition in the niche areas, entrepreneurship and global competency is on right now. And the focus of the space startups is for the disruptive and advanced technologies, services, innovative practices, affordable application to reach all the corners of the society, with the targeted segment as the business, small business concerns and startups. Are you able to see my change in the slides or not?
It's occasionally updating, sir. Now it's updating. It was not updating for a while, but now it's on slide 9.
The key factors you are able to see. The key factor, never mind, because these are all many of the people know, because the wording itself will make sense. The key factors, especially in the space startups of late in the last 2 to 3 years, I have been closely observing the mentoring and handholding support, because space is a very niche area and very highly technical oriented area. Even though the enthusiastic startups comes up with ideas and innovations, they require very intimate knowledge about the space systems. And this particular mentorship and handholding is very important, not only in space sector, but other areas also. They require, especially in the deep tech, let us say areas, the mentoring and handholding is very, very important. Then initial, so all the startups may not be self-sufficient in terms of funding, the seed funding opportunities given by India and departments, and incentives, they are very, very important. Right now, this is available. Only thing is, it has to grow so that many more startups can emerge from the colleges. The incubation and investment, this area particular thing, I am seeing a lot of uncertainty. Why? Because this particular business incubators, they definitely require, they also require fund for managing the incubation centers. But of late, some of these startups, when they are not getting the seed funding and when they have to depend on their self finance, the incubation support is becoming one bottleneck, which requires a focus. So at this point of time, I just want to dwell and propose a new model. Whatever the agencies or associations that they are coming to bridge the gap. Nowadays, because of pandemic or because of reforms or because of globalization, many of the industries, they have started opening up new facilities. Fairly, I understood, I personally know that many of the industries have got the facilities underloaded. Why don't view the major industry? Because it is like a satellite companies. These startups are also like seeds, small baby companies. Baby companies have to be supported by parent companies in one way or other. Any of business incubators also has got an investment model or revenue model, like taking a stake in the ultimately in the final investment after the successful startup program is completed, startup has completed this program. Similar kind of things can be adopted for the industries also. But when I had personal interaction with the industries, they also showed some interest. Why can't our facilities can be thrown open to the startups as an incubation centers? Even though per se, the incubation center will not get qualified, but incubation definitely will get qualified. Whether it is a government organization, private corporate, or private, big companies, they definitely should look for such kind of offering such kind of facilities to startups, so that one way it is giving the support to the startups, baby companies. And second, you can also be competitive, because when startups are bringing the competitiveness into the industry, definitely the industry per se, the product per se will be more competitive. So I urge SIA to just spend some time and some resources on this concept, whether it works out or not can be seen. But again, the same thing when it comes to the support, infrastructure support, procurement support, institutional support is required. If some organizations can give them assurance to buy back, so they will have initial stabilization, initial, sustenance, so that once they pick up during the initial days, after that, they can find their own markets and grow up. And ISRO has thrown some focal areas. I'll just in another two or three slides, I can show some of the concepts where ISRO is interested to grow. So these are all the focus areas, but not exhaustive. These are all the areas one can concentrate to pick up the ideas or business. Again, the current startups is more than, to our knowledge, more than 30 to 35 startups are engaged in all these things. We have been in touch with them. We are also encouraging them, encouraging the new startups to come out of the colleges. I had initial discussion with last week with SpaceFed, which is a very enthusiastic and energetic association, to encourage new startups from the colleges. ISRO has also been in touch with several academia to encourage entrepreneurs as soon as they come out of the college. Of course, the government programs are there. Recently, we have launched Atmanirbhar Bharat, where 6 to 7 new startups were recommended for seed funding up to a maximum of 50 lakhs rupees. And Startup India scheme is now open. It is up to the startups to make use of this program. And incidentally, I have come across in the same NASSCOM report, some local government bodies have initiated these particular support programs, enablers, like in Trivandrum, they have started a space tech park. Similarly, Jaipur, Chandigarh, Ahmedabad. I request all these new entrepreneurs or startups to make use of these facilities, to initiate discussion with them and get into the ecosystem. Of course, ISRO had a very wide range of academia collaboration. Basically, this academia collaboration, when you start inculcating the innovation and research culture, these students who are nurtured in the academia, they come out and ultimately become the entrepreneurs. That is the idea behind tying up with the academia institutions. Of course, technology transfer is one area ISRO offers many technologies at very affordable cost, so that these startups can make use of these technologies and create value-added products with their innovation. And indigenization is a very important activity which is just suited for startups. Most of the things they are converting the packages in the electronics, whether it is electronics or materials, these documents are available in the ISRO website. One can go through and make use of these facilities also. I hope the thought process, what I have put it across, expect some kind of synergy and some kind of thought process. Let the session dwell on many more such aspects from the young people. Let us know how actually, let us create some kind of platform or some kind of thought process, so that it can be made use of for the ecosystem and the startup ecosystem at large. Thank you. And I request Mr. Abhishek Malhotra to take the proceedings further. I'll be witnessing. Probably, I think whenever this one is there, probably my intervention is there. I will just rope in. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for that great introduction and always the words of encouragement, which are extremely important for not only the startup sector, but also all the youngsters associated with this. And it's your lead that that provides the the required impetus for the growth of this sector. So as Dr. Subbarao started his company in the private sector in 1993. He's a veteran in the industry. We have the veterans from ISRO also blessing this gathering. But Dr. Subbarao worked at a time when the concept of startups was alien to the Indian business sector. Today, we are in a regime where nearly in every sphere of business activity, startups are a buzzword. The intent to really open up the space sector, which is demonstrated by the fact that we've seen seven policy documents, draft policy documents in the last less than a year. It's clearly, it's clear from the announcements made by the finance minister in May last year and the follow-up with these draft policy documents that it creates the fertile ground for the startups who have been in this domain for the last 5 to 6 years or even more and who have decided to follow their passion and convert that into not just a dream, but actually a reality. This is an opportune time for the startup sector in the commercial space regime to really grow. The basis for that, the circumstances for that are being provided. The Indian private commercial space sector is young, but so are the pallbearers of this new space revolution in India. So without much further ado, I would like to open this session up and request each of our panelists here today, Sunil Indruti, Sanjay Nekanti, Neha, Karthik and Srinath, to just spend a couple of minutes to introduce themselves and their companies before I can engage them in perhaps a little more interactive and an interesting discussion. We can start with you, Neha.
Thank you, Abhishek. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Neha, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of Astrome. Astrome is a VC-backed deep tech company developing millimeter wave communication technology for both ground and space applications. Our first product is an award-winning E-band backhaul product that solves the last mile backhaul problem for 4G, 5G, and rural broadband networks. We are also gearing up to launch our second product, which is a KU band flat panel terminal. We'll start with KU band and then move on to other frequencies. This would be particularly useful for mobility applications for GEO satellites as well as for LEO satellites, which require smooth handover between satellites for effective communication.
Thanks so much, Neha. Karthik, you're up next.
Okay. Hi, all. My name is Karthik. I'm Chief Operating Officer at SatShore. So what SatShore does is we are a downstream Earth observation imagery analytics company. So we consume the satellite imagery and we provide analytics for banks, insurance, infrastructure monitoring, and likewise, state and central government, central government agencies. We also work internationally with other governments and other countries and other private institutions in Southeast Asia, Europe, all those places. So, thanks.
Thanks, Karthik. Sunil?
Hi. Thanks, Abhishek. So I'd like to thank SIA for the opportunity to speak at this event. My name is Sunil Indurthi, and I'm the Director of Business Development for Azista Aerospace. So we are a satellite manufacturing company. We build satellites in the 50 kilogram to 150 kilogram class. And our USP is that we manufacture about 70% of all the subsystems in-house. And we serve constellations. We position ourselves as an enabler of constellations. I'll probably get an opportunity to give more details about the company as the discussion progresses. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Srinath, may I ask you to introduce yourself and the company?
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Srinath. I'm one of the co-founders and the CEO of Agnikul Cosmos. At Agnikul, we are building a series of small launch vehicles that can really address the going to space problem for small satellites on an on-demand basis. And we're developing new technology, not only on the engine side, but also on other fronts, wherein we can really make this a complete made in India vehicle, to directly address the customer's needs. We usually work out of the IIT Madras ecosystem, which is where we started as a company. And we've been lucky to have raised, a couple of rounds of money so far. And hopefully, if all goes well, sometime towards the later part of next year, we can be trying some actual launches out of India. So thank you.
Thanks, Srinath. All the best for that. Last but not the least, Sanjay.
Thanks, Abhishek. Thanks, SIA, for inviting me for this event. It's estimated that about 20,000 satellites will be launched in the coming decade or so, and this 20,000 number looks like a very conservative estimate. If you look at the recent FCC filings, the numbers could be much higher. So now if you have to launch these 20,000 satellites, there needs to be a fundamental change in how satellites are manufactured, how satellites are launched, and how satellites are operated. That's where Dhruva comes into play. My name is Sanjay. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Dhruva Space. We are a full-stack space engineering solutions company. We work on the space segment, launch segment, as well as the ground segment. On the space segment, we build satellite platforms ranging from a kilogram all the way up to 300 kilograms. On the launch segment, we are primarily building spacecraft launcher interfaces, which are compatible with multiple launch vehicles globally. On the ground segment, we are aggregating Earth stations so that users could just operate their satellite sitting in their home, using a terminal. That's about us.
Thanks so much. Thank you for not only introducing yourselves and your companies, but also sticking to my moderated time limit of a couple of minutes each. With that, let's go to the more interesting part of this discussion. Sunil, yeah. I had a question for you. The topic for today's session is startups connecting to the international market with emerging business model. So if I am to ask you, what exactly is your business model? Could you please talk us through that and let us know, the emerging part of it? How does that work in this interesting and extremely challenging sector?
Yeah, sure. So, as I said, we see ourselves, we position ourselves as a satellite design and manufacturing company, and we see that we are an enabler of constellations. So, for example, there are companies such as SpaceX and Amazon that can afford to set up their own manufacturing and assembly lines owing to their huge in-house demands and appetites of their, billionaire founders. These are the exceptions. Right, but there are a number of satellite operators and service providers who don't necessarily have the expertise required to manufacture satellites, and they might not even want to dilute their focus. Right, so to establish heritage for space qualified systems and subsystems is a very time consuming and expensive affair, and not everybody has the technical capability, funds, or the time to do it, in concurrence with their core activity, let's say, of providing services with a specific payload or building a payload. So this is where we come in. We work as partners with these companies, and we enable to achieve their goals. Low Earth orbit satellites have enabled, or they do enable, a huge number of industries, right, with very path-breaking business models. But these companies that are coming from various other industries, they don't necessarily understand, or they're not very well positioned to make the best choices for their space assets. So most often what we do is we work closely with our partner companies to understand their requirements. We help them build a business case and then develop and manufacture the satellites for them. So basically at our facility in Ahmedabad, which is around 50,000 square feet in area, and we have all the environmental test facilities under a single roof. So basically all the satellites, manufacturing, AIT, everything is done in a single facility. So what we are trying to do is address the mass manufacturing problem by vertically integrating ourselves. And currently, I would say we manufacture about 70% of all the subsystems in-house. And by end of next year, we would be manufacturing all the subsystems except for propulsion. So this helps us customize solutions for a wide array of customer requirements, and while we maintain great control over quality and timelines. So yeah, I mean, this I would say So in a single line, I would say, you know, we are basically a solution provider, you know, for constellations.
Sure, I think that's instructive. You know, moving on to Sanjay, the business models, perhaps generically, that are available in the startup domain in India, clearly are emerging. They're unique. Sunil just talked us through his company's business model. When you are approaching, you know, because at the end of the day, a startup, for it to work, you need investors, you need to have some sort of fuel to take you, pardon me for using that particular word, but you need fuel to take you through the motions and perhaps even launch the satellite. So what do you sell as your USP when you're approaching an investor?
Right. So I think in general, there are some key points that investors are always looking across. I think I would have interacted with about 150 investors so far. So, you know, I'll just try to recollect some of these questions and then highlight upon what we talk about through a space when we speak with
sir. Sir, exactly. PSG or PCB also the same points were dealt. And when LPSC also came with the same proposal, some optimization was suggested and they have also done the optimization. But characterization part, because the other industries, they may not be interested for our characterization part. I think we should have a facility exclusively, which ultimately when it will fulfill the results, definitely the outside R&D can be taken up. But these facilities
are... Sir, if you can put yourself on mute, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. Go on, Sanjay.
Yeah, so some key points is, you know, is there a technology as a differentiator? Can this company become a leader in the domain? Does the company really have a stellar team to execute? And, you know, what is the scalability in the long run? And, you know, do you think the company can do an exponential shareholder value growth over a larger period of time? What is the policy talking about? And, you know, last but not the least, everybody wants to understand if the startup that they're investing would it become a unicorn? So let's talk about, technology as a differentiator. I think, when we talk about Dhruva Space, we're already talking about strong IP at different systems or subsystems that we have developed. We are already executing some very interesting contracts, like we're building space-grade solar panels. We're probably one of the very few companies around the world who has capabilities to build space-grade solar panels. So from a technology as a differentiator standpoint, we already have those mixes that we mentioned to investors. With respect to, showcasing as a leader in the domain, I think, as I mentioned, our core is we want to be a full stack player, wherein we build the satellite for the customer, we are able to launch the satellite and give them the keys to operate it. So these are some early blocks that we are currently building, and the recognition from Government of India by virtue of Startup India Awards, etc., have been super helpful in showcasing our capabilities or being recognized by the key stakeholders in the ecosystem. Now, with respect to do we have a stellar team to execute? I think we have a mix of engineers who are electrical engineers, but also space engineers. But the most important part is we work with a lot of former ISRO scientists who have decades of experience, you know, bringing in that capabilities to execute things. So this this builds that confidence with investors. I think one of the very important aspects which investors would like to understand is how does the scalability look like in the long run. So today we are mostly doing B2G, business to government contracts, but you know, do we have a B2B play, B2G play, and a B2C play? So I think for from a satellite manufacturer, we could always transition towards a satellite enabled service in the future, so that scalability is showcased. And then, you know, in terms of increasing shareholder value, in terms of investment made, you know, when there is the steady growth year on year, there's always a multiple which the investor gets in terms of return. And there are also exit options that are provided. So that makes it very interesting, or, you know, for investors to look at. And in general, I think policy, regarding the policy, you know, investors are very keen to understand whether the upcoming policy is a barrier or an enabler. And I think over the last few years, the steps that have been taken by ISRO and other key stakeholders have been very, very helpful, like, you know, in terms of having grants, etc. So that's also providing an impetus for investors to look at deep tech companies or space companies. But I think, you know, there's still room for improvement, or, you know, things can get better in the long run. And last but not the least, you know, trying to understand, will the company really become a unicorn? I think that's one of the common questions which everybody asks, and that is where, you know, I give this example. So, you know, SpaceX started building the reusable launch vehicle, but the largest contract that they won was for building the crew capsule taking astronauts to the space station. That was not that was not what they started with, but that was what they built over a course of time. So I think, you know, that scalability needs to be shown to the investor, and the investor needs to understand how the business can reach to the masses in the long run. And these are some of the things that we provide, and we've been fairly successful, I would say.
Thanks, Tan. That's, you know, quite not only music to my ears, but that of all people aspiring to get into any type of startup sort of domain, and specifically in this area. That's a fair summary of that. You know, going on to some more specific brass tacks, Neha, what do you see, or what have you seen as the challenges that deep tech companies have faced in developing their products in India? Because, you know, at the end of the day, we're talking about getting into the international market and connecting to the international market. So what are the challenges that deep tech companies face in making those products in India?
Yes, thanks, Abhishek. So it's a very interesting question, and something that we can, of course, relate to, not just because of our journey, but also because of all the other startups that we've seen, especially in the deep tech sector, in various sectors, you know, not just space, but every other vertical. So one of the things, the key thing that is missing in the Indian ecosystem, which actually impacts the deep tech startups, is time to scale. And time to scale is majorly driven by two factors. The first factor is access to risk capital. And we're not just talking about seed capital, but we're talking about Series A, Series B, Series C kind of capital. And the second thing that is important to, you know, accelerate that scaling is actually early access to market, which is, you know, really early feedback from the market, you know, about what you're developing and how it fits into the ecosystem. Because a lot of time, deep tech technology takes a while to develop, and, you know, getting that early feedback is absolutely critical, you know, to reach that stage. And you can see both of these things happening very effectively in some of the global Silicon Valley, for example, Silicon Valley startup ecosystem, where there is risk capital available very early on, but not just limited to seed money, but, you know, pre-Series A, Series A, Series B, Series C. And people have that attitude of taking risk on new things, which may not have been done before anywhere in the world. So that's kind of, you know, what is missing, because of which I think deep tech startups in India do not scale at the rate that they scale, you know, let's say in Silicon Valley. The second thing that, you know, can change is what I mentioned about the early market, you know, feedback and access. And that is primarily, that can be driven by government as well as big companies, you know, having that attitude of buying from startups and engaging with startups at an early stage, you know, and that's really very, very important that I think is missing, or if it's there, it's really slow. The process of getting feedback from big companies, from the government is very slow. So I think these two things probably are the biggest challenge that a deep tech startup in India faces. And that's that makes it, you know, sort of, you know, really slow to scale up as compared to its global counterparts, you know. And as you know, in business, time to market is everything. So that's kind of, you know, what I would say.
Before I move on to the next question, Neha, a follow up on what I what your answer was, is the intellectual property regime, the protection available, and the manner in which tech transfer and IP sort of rights interface and work in India, is that also one of the factors that is faced in the form of a challenge, or is it, or do you consider it to be more in terms of an opportunity and something that, you know, can be worked on?
So from our personal experience, I don't think that has been a challenge for us. But I think we have not completed our complete journey. So I would reserve my comments on that, especially with matters about, you know, related to how do you sell your IP, intellectual property, or you transfer it even, you know, between countries. That is something that we are, you know, yet to experience. And but overall, our experience of filing intellectual property has been pretty smooth. But that being said, a deep tech startup needs to, you know, protect their IP globally. Of course, the court system in India is not the best, as we all know. It's extremely slow. That, you know, makes the intellectual property protection less effective as compared to, let's say, if you had the same IP filed in US and you were actually, you know, protecting it there in the US. So I think those are things that should be, I would say, made strengthened in the country, you know, because ultimately we as a country will be valued, you know, due to our intellectual property. Unless we just want to be a manufacturing hub, which is not going to gain us that status of being, you know, in the top tier economies in the world who drive the global business.
Thanks for that, Neha. In fact, just one bit of input from my end, because I do get an opportunity to practice in the IP domain in India. And in the last 22 years that I've been practicing, I've actually seen a positive change in the protection and enforcement levels of intellectual property in the country, with more and more courts not only getting IP savvy, but also understanding the value of the interim injunctions to protect the value of IP. So I'm only hoping that that same thought process continues, percolates, and is helpful to the industry overall. Karthik, Mr. Sudhir talked about quite a few of the initiatives that have been carried out in the recent past in terms of the support that is to be given to the startups overall, and you know, specifically startups in the area that we are talking about. But what, according to you, can the government do additionally to help startups not only connect to, which is the topic of this particular session, but also compete in the international market?
So right now, if I could relate how the space industry is, it is kind of like entering into the 1990s LPG reforms type of environment, where we are moving from what is it, regulatory to facilitation alone from the government rather than control and other stuff. So that is a good movement in terms of the draft policies and things released and all those stuff enabling. But even then, we need more clarity in actually how it can actually operate, meaning there are, let's say, there, for example, because we are a downstream company, we use exclusive, like a hell lot of satellite imagery, and the imagery itself is subject to a lot of security in the sense that what all areas you can image and then what are the things and all. So if we are going to operate at let's say a regional level of like at least a Southeast Asia or something, and then they don't have a capacity to capture an imagery of a particular place, and we come through channel of like Indian government, but there is a clause in the draft itself that okay, so government reserves any right based on the international obligations or something, which is a very vaguely put wording. So all those things are there, so that has to be smoothened out. And apart from that, the organizations, meaning when we are interested to work in like the other geographies and things like that, so the first thing what is that if government helps us to move through an MOU kind of stuff to you know, give us a recognition that okay, this is a, like at least a security cleared company, that okay, you can trust them and start doing a business with them. Because that's exactly the case happened when we were first time entering into Philippines market for a agri lending portfolio. We working with their government and other government agencies. At that time, there was an MOU actually being signed with our honorable president of India, Mr. Kovind, and their president, and we were a part of that the entire thing. And then it started as a pilot project, and then we moved into full scale crop monitoring portfolio for like a million hectares of area kind of stuff. So let's say if we want to operate, we also want to operate in other regions like Cambodia or Indonesia, where getting entry into the market itself is, there is a huge barrier because of various reasons. There is no push and there is no agencies in their country equivalent to our CII or here SIA and things like that. So in those cases, if government could support us through some that like a trade facilitation, so it would be very much helpful for, to know, to directly enter into the market. So there are two markets. One is their incumbents into their own countries, not much, but also the other international players who have already got into through some other channels where Indian market, Indian players are not able to get into them because it's a little difficult to get things done through our government, meaning process is slow. Yeah. So these are the things
Sure. So I think I will come back to the panel with a little more, directed and specific question. But I have one question for Srinath. Srinath, you mentioned that you've been successful more recently in raising funds for the company in terms of what, from investors. But what, according to you, if you were to sort of give some sort of guidance, what, according to you, have you guys done correctly or not done correctly? And specifically, what is your input on how a company, a startup in India, can connect to the international market?
Sure. So I think I would say three things which I think we didn't totally exactly plan it, but it sort of aligned. So I'll talk about that without taking too much credit for it. I always give a lot of credit to coincidence as well in any startup journey, including ours. The first thing was finding the right academic partner, right? It started off by cold calling a bunch of professors. And it so happened that someone at IIT Madras, Professor Satya Chakravarti, was interested. And that definitely gave us at least a platform to be taken seriously, because otherwise me and my other co-founder, Moin, we are not exactly from a rocket background, right? And sometimes that is needed to at least convince investors that, you are doing something the right direction. The second thing that was going well is I think we were able to break down the product realization roadmap into I mean, some level of meaningful prototypes that there is always some output to show, because the final output always, particularly with space tech, there's so much qualification out there, and the actual final product that will be flying is always quite, you know, down the line. But if you end up directly targeting that, then that becomes a little messy. And I think we were able to break it down in the right possible, in the right, you know, kind of possible milestones, and actually show output to people. So investors who we initially met, or customers who we initially met who didn't really buy into what we were saying, slowly started to see some progress, and that kind of built over time. So I think that helped us definitely. And then the one thing that helped, I think, almost all space tech startups in India was this whole in-space thing that happened. And that's what I think definitely, you know, it was this, you take every bit of ammunition that you can get to pitch when you go for the next round of fundraising. And that happened because in-space was, you know, announced. And then we also again got lucky and became the first company in the country to sign with, you know, an agreement with them. And so all of those things slowly started to build momentum. And then after all this, I think the fundamental thing is product started to work, right? Like, we did our engine firing. The team did extraordinary amount of work in actually making that happen. So one thing led to the other, and we used each thing to, you know, push the other variable a little. And that's how the round came together. And that's how everything that we've been able to accomplish so far was possible. So I think we are just trying to ourselves learn from, you know, what did we actually carefully measure and do, and what sort of happened by chance, and if we can also learn from that and replicate it again, so that we can continue with our Series B. And there is definitely, you know, more to be done in terms of building our vehicle, in terms of sprint day, you know, in terms of actually making a production line out of it, and so on. So that is, I would say, 2-3 things that other startups can follow as well, particularly when it comes to building space tech hardware. Find the right academic partner, break it down into smaller milestones, and keep showing progress, hardware progress, which will automatically start building faith both in customers and in investors.
Great, thanks. The one aspect of this session which I think deliberately I've kept for the end, and it's an open question which I'd like everyone's comments on. The session does talk about startups reaching out and connecting to the international market using their emerging business models. Now, when it comes to the international market, is there some specific, let's say, strategy or an ask that you have? Strategy is something that you may be possibly implementing or needing to implement, and a specific ask that you have. Karthik mentioned that the ask from Satshaw's point of view would be that there should be a greater government facilitation when you're outreaching, you're making an outreach to other countries. Are similar asks available with any of you? Have you thought about those? What do you think it would take for a startup to actually go out and connect in and compete with in the international market? You guys can go as you would like. I mean, perhaps we can start with Karthik. You've already given a precursor, so perhaps we can go back to Sunil and then come back again to you a little later.
Yeah. So Abhishek, what I think is that in order to be able to compete or take the product to a global stage, particularly, I would say, the startups or the companies that are the amazing array of new companies that have come out in India, they are in no way lesser compared to the ones that are up in the US or Europe. What is only required, I think, from the government's standpoint is an equal platform in terms of a very fair platform in terms of policies, right? I mean, if they are made very clear what is the government stand on, let's say, on frequency allocation or for launch, right? If it is laid out very clearly, I mean, I'm sure we have been working, as you already mentioned, for the past 1 year, so many drafts have been circulated. We are making progress. The sooner we lay out something openly, that okay, this is how the space industry is going to function, the better it is for the industry, I mean, and the players. Because it is all about, when we work with investors or when we work with potential customers, they are all concerned about the lack of clarity sometimes. everybody seeks to move away from uncertainty as much as possible. So, yeah, I mean, my request would be to come up with a set of laws that would enable us to start working. I'm sure this is a process that keeps evolving. I mean, the set of laws that govern space in India will keep evolving, and that's a work in progress. But we should start somewhere and start soon.
Thanks, Anil. Sanjay, you raised your hand. Something else you need to contribute?
Yeah. Recently, government of Oman had come up with a tender for building a large geostationary satellite for them. I think we are probably maybe very few companies in the world who had actually went ahead and bought this tender. Now, the order value could be anywhere between $150 to $300 million. So I think, some of these conversations, when it happens with the support of the government could be super, super helpful. Wherein this, a true partnership which the government has been looking for, right? Wherein industry government partnership to serve the needs of global needs, etc. Right. So here we could look at a industry and ISRO collaboration to meet some of these requirements. So this is just one example that I could think of. In addition to this, I think. Sometimes, we get a lot of inquiries from a lot of companies from around the world. And it might be very difficult for us to ascertain whether that company exists, it doesn't exist, are we allowed to do business with them, not do business with them, etc. So I think a one-stop facilitation which would enable us to navigate through these roadblocks would be super helpful.
Great. Perhaps if the opportunity presents itself and there is enough traction around it, maybe SIA could be that facilitator acting as an interface between industry and government to enable some sort of a one-stop solution to be provided to the industry and specifically the startups. One of the aspects that I'm bringing in a little bit of a modification to my question earlier, when you are looking at competing in the international market, because of the fact that there are the WTO and trade agreements in place between countries, and even though it's a principle that's much older than the WTO and it's time tested, there is this principle of international reciprocity. So very often one gets to hear that, at least in the international fora, that look, if in India the policy requires or demands that it will be concentrated towards developing the infrastructure only locally, only for Indian companies, and thereby, axiomatically perhaps exclude foreign companies, then how do we allow, or we're not going to allow, Indian companies to that extent to come and compete in the international market? Is that a concern? And if so, some thoughts about it as to how we can sort of work together and collaboratively and try and resolve that. Neha, why don't you go on that?
I think government plays a very important role in terms of telling the world, what they are promoting and what their industry is capable of. So I definitely think that, in terms of our image as a country, it can improve quite drastically because we are not known as a country of innovators. To be very frank, we go abroad and innovate, of course, that we do. But the reason for that is because the ecosystem is not geared towards accepting innovation and new things, And so that is something that can only come when the message is going top down, not just internally, but also externally, to external stakeholders that look at us as innovators, And I think that's something that we need to do. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question directly, but from my point of view, I think that is something that we need to change as a country, in terms of our image in the world. And the second thing is that we need to take more pride, on what we do. At the same time, we also have to not take pride on things which are, we have to be careful. We have to be careful as a society whom we, what we take pride in, because otherwise it can also give the wrong message that, okay, we are really not valuing what we should value. I know that was very vague, but
no, I understand. I think the message is well received. Sunil, before you add to that, I'm just taking a point from what you had initially mentioned, and I'm inviting a comment from you on that. You mentioned that, not only from an investor's point of view, but from a stakeholder's point of view, from a continuity and longevity point of view, the one aspect that needs a greater amount of perhaps thrashing out is clarity in the regulatory domain, clarity in what the policy dictates, and perhaps, if I can, say this as an extension of that clarity, is the need perhaps for a commercial space legislation which sets out very clearly the rights and liabilities of parties. So just that one point before you comment on what you wanted to say.
Yeah, I mean, very much. There is the need to understand, what are the liabilities or the opportunities that various stakeholders have when they act in this Indian space ecosystem. So, yeah, I'd say yes. Yeah, there is a need. So,
but you also wanted to say something before I
interrupted. Yeah. So, I mean, the question of being protectionist, right, about not really being very very welcome to foreign players and how that would affect Indian companies going out into the global markets. I have a slightly different point of view. Like, I wouldn't be too concerned. Traditionally, we have been a little protectionist, right? I mean, India as a nation for the past 30 years, though we have opened up slowly across various sectors. But I think, I mean, we are generally a nation that is that has been very progressive. I mean, let me take the example of China. Okay, you know how difficult it is to do business in China, right? For even the biggest companies in the world, let's say the Googles or the Microsofts. And you see Chinese companies getting out into Europe or US, and then Tencent or Baidu or Alibaba, for that matter, numerous other Chinese companies that we don't even know about. In the past 10 years, they have been very slowly but surely increasing their share of global revenue significantly. Okay. So what that tells is that China is a threat to the world. Everybody acknowledges that. But still, Chinese companies do get out into the world and they make their mark, they make their revenues. And they're very smart. So as a private player, you've got to find your ways. And I'm sure India is definitely a much, much, is very well. I mean, the outlook towards India is extremely, extremely good when you compare it with China, right, among the Western players or, for that matter, any other country in the world. So I would say, we shouldn't be too concerned about it.
No, great. I think just to sum up our discussion, startups in India in the commercial space sector have emerging and interesting business models. Some of those business models have been tested by investors and given the right ticks in the right boxes. The current level of policy and regulatory regime has been supportive to a large extent. However, there is perhaps need for a greater clarity and maybe even a commercial space law, which gives a greater impetus for not only the industry to grow, but also the ecosystem overall to benefit therefrom. I think with that, thank you very much for the panelists. Thank you so much, Sudhir sir, for joining us and sharing this session. It's been really wonderful having all of you here. And thanks a lot once again. Over to you, Vimi.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Before we close the session, if I can request Mr. Sudhir, if there are any closing remarks also you would like to give, for the session and then...
Yes. And very ably conducted. Thanks, Mr. Abhishek. I think quite younger energetic guys. They're all successful startups. Probably some of the ideas what I have thrown, probably the new startups which are just entering or jumping into the ocean of startup require some kind of liberalization and support. And of course, Neha also supported that the corporates have to come forward, open their doors for in some way or other, either backup or I was already mentioned, because these are all the some of the things which have, we have discussed. Probably, I think, let us see the recommendations of such kind of agencies and institutions come forward. Probably, I think these are all the initial days to tighten our belts. Let us hope that the startups ecosystem will grow further as it was envisaged. Thanks a lot.